Welcome, and thank you for joining the Celebration of Inclusiveness in Medicine and Science Distinguished Lecture, honoring Dr. Raul Vazquez, our keynote speaker, and the recipient of the 2021 Volunteer of the Year Award from the UB Medical Alumni Association. Before we begin, with formal introductions, let me provide background information about the Jacobs School of Office of Inclusion and Cultural Enhancement and the Celebration of Inclusiveness Lecture. The Office of Inclusion and Cultural Enhancement, established in 2012, has been guided by the Mark Nivet quote that states, diversity doesn't occur alone with excellence or in spite of excellence, but is the integral part of excellence and success in any institution. The Office of Inclusion promotes diversity, equity, inclusion, and belonging, and embraces cultural differences as a means to achieve excellence in research, education, and healthcare. This Celebration of Inclusiveness in Medicine and Science Distinguished Lecture is sponsored by the Office of Inclusion and Cultural Enhancement that I direct as Senior Associate Dean for Diversity and Inclusion. It's also sponsored by UB Alumni Association, is represented by Dr. Daniel Sheehan, President of the Medical Alumni Association. We have also, as partners, Student National Medical Association, SNMA, represented by Nadia Basket, MD candidate class of 2024, who is also Community Service Chair of SNMA and the Like Clinic. So we have also Polite Student Government, represented by Amanda Geiger, MD candidate class of 2024, who is president of Polity. And finally, the Office of Medical Advancement, represented by Jennifer Setsemini, Senior Director of Medical Advancement, and Jennifer Britton, Senior Director of Health Science Engagement. The Jacob School, in addition to today's exciting events, I am proud to share that the Jacobs School of Medicine and Biomedical Science will participate in UB Giving Day beginning on Thursday, April 29. The Jacobs School has established the Scholastic Leadership Award for medical students in the name of Joseph Robert Lab, the first African-American graduate from the UB School of Medicine and from UB in 1880. This award will be presented annually as a way to inspire our students and to honor Lab's lifelong commitment to promoting core values that advance social justice, equality, and excellence in healthcare. Gifts to the Jacobs School of Medicine and Biomedical Science Memorial Fund in memory of Dr. Joseph Robert Lab will help us to achieve our goal of creating a name fund at the medical school. And with further support, this name fund can become an endowment fund. If you're interested in learning more or want to support this fund, please contact Jennifer Setsemini at the Medical Advancement Office. It is now my pleasure to introduce to you Dr. Michael Kane, Vice President for Health Science and Dean of the Jacobs School of Medicine and Biomedical Science, who will provide welcoming remarks. Dr. Kane.
Thank you, Margarita, and welcome and good afternoon to everyone. So on behalf of the Jacobs School of Medicine and Biomedical Sciences, I'm most pleased to participate in today's lecture as we do celebrate Diversity Month, and as Margarita just mentioned, the opportunity to honor Dr. Raul Vazquez as the Distinguished Volunteer of the Year. So congratulations, Raul. please accept my sincere thanks for your services to our community and our school. It is greatly appreciated. In addition, I would also like to acknowledge Margarita for recently being named as the 2021 Scientific Achievement Award winner, and for also being selected as one of 19 fellows into the American Society of Pharmacology and Experimental Therapeutics. So congratulations, Margarita, as you receive this notable award in science later this week. As the Jacobs School celebrates Diversity Month and its 175th anniversary this year, we are grateful for alumni like Dr. Vazquez and his efforts to address health disparity in our local community. Improving health outcomes is a top priority of our school, and with the partners such as Raul and others who have helped lead by working hard in communities they serve, these models become excellent examples of how it can be achieved. Over the past year, the Jacobs School, in response to many recommendations made by our students last spring, has instituted a plan and a commitment to further enhance the culture of inclusion here at the school. Such efforts will focus on highlighting diversity, bettering health outcomes, and eliminating racism in health. Margarita gave one of many examples. The second one is that the school has recently established 8 paid fellowships in social justice and equity, administration, and leadership. And this new program will embed both medical students and biomedical science graduate students in projects that are either within our decanal unit, department, or healthcare system that address social, educational, or healthcare inequities. Students chosen as inaugural social justice and equity administration and leadership fellows will devote up to 120 hours working with a primary project mentor and a project team. Fellows may work on the research and design, implementation, or analysis of a project. We encourage projects that provide opportunities to participate in institutional change, such as policy development or process improvement, and work with interprofessional, clinical, or administrative teams. The goal of this fellowship is to develop a cadre of leaders with skills to advance equity and justice in institutions and community-based organizations, either within our university and school or wherever this group of 8 leaders a year reside when they're finished their training. So getting back to today's lecture, which serves as a great example of how a collaborative effort, as you saw, between our faculty, alumni, staff, and student groups can truly help us achieve our objectives in highlighting our culture and inclusion events here at the school. So I'm most pleased to be available and here today. And Raul, thank you again. And Margarita, I will return the program to you.
Thank you. Thank you, Dr. Kane. And thank you for the congratulations also. So it is my pleasure now to introduce Dr. Daniel Sheehan, who is the president of the UV Medical Alumni Association. Dr. Sheehan is a clinical professor in the Department of Pediatrics and Associate Dean for Medical Curriculum in the Jacobs School of Medicine and Biomedical Science. In his role as president of the UV Medical Alumni Association, Dr. Sheehan will introduce Dr. Vazquez and present Dr. Vazquez with the UV Medical Alumni Association 2021 Volunteer of the Year Award. Dr. Sheehan.
Thank you, Margarita and Dean Kane. As president of the MAA and on behalf of Dean Kane and today's partners, it is my sincere honor to present this year's Distinguished Medical Alumni Volunteer of the Year Award to Dr. Raul Vazquez, our featured speaker. Every year we honor one distinguished medical alumni volunteer who is recognized for their outstanding contributions to both medicine and efforts in the community. Dr. Vazquez graduated from UB in 1989 and is a primary care physician and founder and chief executive officer of the Greater Buffalo United Accountable Healthcare Network, as well as the founder and president of Urban Family Practice. He has built an integrative primary care model that serves the Black and Brown communities. And over this past year, he has led significant and important efforts to educate and vaccinate the community to protect them from COVID. You know, I think we are all excited to hear about his personal story and learn more about how his organization is tackling COVID efforts in the community. As he continues to influence and touch so many people, we are so proud and so grateful to be able to recognize Dr. Vazquez for his commitment to UB and the community health of families and our neighbors in the City of Good Neighbors. We are fortunate today to be able to present this award live as his daughters, Nadia and Nina, who are helping with today's program, present him with his award. Congratulations, Dr. Vazquez. Your daughters are on their way.
Okay, there. Which is in the dark. Okay.
So thank you for being such an inspiration to so many. Everyone, please join me in congratulating and welcoming the 2021 Distinguished Medical Alumni Volunteer of the Year, Dr. Raul Vazquez, who will now discuss understanding inequities in communities of color.
That was so sweet. So, you know, today, my name is Dr. Raul Vazquez. However, that has not always been my title. I was born a little Puerto Rican boy in the South Bronx. A single mom raised my brother, my two brothers and me. My mom called me Rucho. I attended many schools throughout my scholastic career, not because I was an Army brat, but because, you know, The award for my daughter is just, it was a little, I'm sorry. So I attended many schools throughout my scholastic career, not because I was an Army brat, because I was not, not because I liked changing schools, because I didn't. The fact were that we attended many schools because we moved around a lot. We had to flee our home dozens of times because of domestic violence or because my mom couldn't afford a rent. Me and my two younger brothers were raised on Medicaid in various projects. I attended different schools in Puerto Rico, New York, New Jersey, Pennsylvania, and Connecticut. I learned the 26-letter alphabet in English on the mainland and 30-letter alphabet when on the island of Puerto Rico. I had to use both languages interchangeably. I dreamt in Spanish, spoke in English at school, listened to English and Spanish music and spoke Spanglish with my cousins. My cousins and I spent a lot of time together. We would often live with them when we were homeless. We'd dance, we played stickball, we laugh and have fun with each other. Nevertheless, we weren't serious about school. It was always optional. If we went to school, it was okay. But if we didn't go to school, it was okay too. So most of us never finished high school, and many of us fell prey to the streets, either ended up in jail or early graves. However, I was always different. I wanted something more. I wanted to be a doctor. School was not a priority in my household or my community, but it was a priority for me. Although I did not personally know any doctor, I always aspired to become one. I recall going to the local hospital emergency room with my Uncle Joe and feeling distressed because neither the staff nor the physicians could understand Uncle Joe's Spanish dialect. He had severe asthma and often needed many treatments. I would be his little translator. But even at an early age, I knew that some pertinent content was being lost or misinterpreted. After all, I was just a kid. I vowed to alleviate the dilemma by becoming a physician for misunderstood and underrepresented people. I was the first in my family to ever graduate from high school. Subsequently, I graduated from Fordham University in 1985 after getting accepted to 10 out of 11 medical schools. My sights were set up on University of Buffalo. I graduated from UB in 1989. And for the next 3 years, I completed a residency in family practice at the Deacon's in Buffalo General Hospital. I've held several administrative and staff responsibilities at many institutions, including Chiat Hospital, Columbus Hospital, and Kaleida Health Systems. I also hold an associate clinical professor from the UB Department of Family Medicine. I'm board certified and a fellow of the American Academy of Family Practice. However, a few of my most significant accomplishments include the development of Urban Family Practice, BC, the Greater Buffalo United Accountable Healthcare Network, G Health Enterprises, and the Raul and Tony Vazquez Foundation. I founded a prior practice on August 9th, 5th of 1996. At the time, many people were discouraging us from building a practice on the west side of Buffalo. They said that we would never be profitable. However, they were wrong. Not only were we profitable, but most important, our communities profited. They received quality services from persons that looked like them and spoke their language and understood their culture. We gave our community a reason to dream big. They were able to see themselves in us, and we were able to see us in them. I often say that the eyes can only see what the mind knows. If you can't see it, then you can't believe that it is possible. I was able to and be. In October 2003, I moved our practice to a newly built state-of-the-art, totally computerized medical facility located on Lower's West Side. I also co-founded GBON as a CEO in January of 2013, and I proudly serve an underrepresented community of beautiful, diverse, and otherwise forgotten people. I am proud to be an inspiration and a mentor to many young people who look up to me and believe that they too can accomplish their dreams. Today, Urban Family Practices service over 14,000 patients and their families. And GBON coordinates overall healthcare and wellness for over 8,500 Medicaid recipients. I've had an opportunity to employ over 250 sustainable, permanent, and livable jobs for our community. Our staff has often offered hundreds of COVID testing and vaccinations. The dreams that I had to serve my people in the community that looked like me have been realized because of the education that I received. I never gave up pursuing my dream, neither should you. Reach for the impossible, obtain the improbable, and be the inspiration to one or to many. Muhammad Ali, quoted. Am I boring somebody? No, I'm sorry. Muhammad Ali's quote says, I said that I am the greatest before I knew I was. So I just want to thank you guys for this award. It's amazing because it brings so many things in my life together. And I just want you to dream big. So I wanted to kind of talk to you a little bit of what we did. As a primary care physician, we don't understand how important that is in these communities because we do a lot and often we don't get the recognition for doing that. And I think this is a very special moment. So health equities have been around for a while. And since I opened up my practice in 1996, we ran into a lot of issues, but we've been able to kind of grow from that. And if you can go to the next slide, just the way that we provide care has to change. And so we got mobile units because not everybody can make it to the office. Some people are confined to their home. And in some cases, we have to often go into our communities to really do things. And COVID-19 really opened my eyes to testing where we couldn't really, you know, people just couldn't make it to places, but we had to find a way to get to them. And then the vaccine process. The next slide, the mobile unit really has an examining room. It has labs. It has everything that we really have stationary that really has to go out into our communities because of the disparities that exist. And not everyone often has a primary care physician. So this is our way to kind of open up the doors during this time of COVID-19. Next slide. So groups that were hit the hardest were the ones that we focused on at Urban Family Practice and G-Health. You notice that among African-Americans, Latinos, and Native Americans, high infection rates, hospitalization, and death rates. Next slide. And here, if you're looking at the numbers that we're seeing, they're very significant in terms of the cases that affected Latinos, African-Americans, and the death rates that occur within those groups based on their population. And, you know, being from the Bronx, I was really, really kind of saddened that I found out, you know, 3,700 people died at home because they were so scared, and they all died from COVID later on. So there's just, even in areas where I train, there's still that disparity where people don't have access to care the way they need to. Next slide. Again, the criteria that was set up initially for the vaccination and who was at risk was real important, but it didn't get to us fast enough. We found that there was just a difference in terms of how the criteria for even vaccination was being deployed. Next slide. You can go to the next slide. This is basically the vaccinations that exist out there. And I think for us, we wanted to, as a primary care physician, I got into the vaccine and really the management of COVID because of my daughter, Nadia, that actually gave me the award, who got COVID back in March and really set my eyes to become a virologist, infectious disease, to kind of understand this because it was very scary at the time. And we were all trying to learn. And for me, this was my daughter. So I had no second chance. I really had to learn this. Next slide. You can go back one slide. Here, you know, what I did like about the different vaccines, the Moderna and Pfizer during the time, was it was a large number of population. And remember, you're having a situation where everyone in the community is very scared. They're scared because they don't know what this is. And, you know, the Black and Brown communities and the Native communities have always been sort of, you know, we've had bad outcomes with the health system in this country. And just having something come out presented as new and then all this fake information that exists, they were very scared. So we try to show the data that there were numbers of African American, Latinos, and Natives within the studies of these two vaccines. That was one that was important because I've seen a lot of drug studies where you pretty much don't have any of these groups. So this was the first start in terms of getting people to understand why the vaccine was important. Next slide. In terms of the vaccinations, one of the things that surprised me was the Native population initially, and this is back on 4/14/21, we've only vaccinated 178,000 Natives. They got the first shot. And so that to me was almost like, you know, the Native population has been here for so long, and so we wanted to make an effort. But when you saw the numbers of Latino and African American, it started to grow to the point that, you know, you were talking about 7 million cases of vaccines given to Latinos and almost 6 million to African Americans. So it became easier to kind of sell to the communities to kind of take this vaccine. And, you know, I often would tell them, I mean, America's never created a vaccine that would hurt white America, and they're on the front line. You know, the Black and Brown populations that are getting hit need to understand that and really go through a learning process, because if we don't, we're gonna lose more than the numbers that we're seeing initially on the mortality list. Next slide. So one of the things that we did was, I have 220 employees at the time, and we were trying to get people to understand the vaccine. This is back it was in January, where we couldn't get vaccines as a primary care physician. Some of the health centers were able to get it, and I was able to talk to Dr. Glick at Jericho, and so he had some extra ones and called me. But during that weekend, which is a little bit odd, I was trying to get a pre-vaccination survey from all of the staff. And this is the question that they have. You know, a lot of them, I won't say the words they mentioned, absolutely not, because, you know, we're speaking, but they were not, they weren't going to do this at all. Next slide. And I think what would happen here was, I wanted to give you a little bit of an assessment in terms of the gender, in terms of the race, and in terms of the age group, which is a lot of what we see now in terms of the groups. And so we kind of went along this process together. Next slide. And so, you know, we asked them, what is your uncertainty about the vaccine, the side effects? Everyone was talking about the side effects. I don't want to catch COVID from this thing. And then we tried to describe them to the fact that there was no virus. This was a new form of technology, but it existed in the past that we were using for COVID that tricked the body to develop these spike proteins so that you would be protected and you built antibiotics. And so that became an interesting thing. And they weren't really concerned that the leadership was going to take the vaccine. So they say, well, it'd be okay. I think the next slide. What we did was we ended up taking the team and we became, you know, myself, I was the first one to get the vaccine when we got the Moderna. And so that often became a sort of sign. I'm doing it. My wife did it. At the time, the girls worked for me and they were also medical students. They were able to get the vaccine. So now I always told them, if I'm giving this to my daughters, my wife, I mean, myself, you know, it's something that you need to kind of think twice about. And I think for a lot of them, they started to get more of an understanding. The next slide of why it would be important to get the vaccine. So during this time, one of the things that we found was, so everyone got the first shot and we wanted to talk to people. So everyone came back. And remember, we had individuals that were refusing that did get the shot. And as a result of that, they had good and great experiences during the time. The first shot just provided, you know, they only had pain at the site. That was the biggest thing, unless they had COVID in the past. So if they had COVID in the past, they had memory cells and they were developing some signs that really lasted, next slide, lasted for about, you know, a day or two after that. And the symptoms were getting better. You can go to the next slide. And again, this is the survey of the second dose. We were trying to make it equitable so that everyone was getting the vaccine within the groups, which I thought was real important, because when we saw the deployment at one point, there was not, you know, some groups were getting the vaccine, some zip codes, but then the rest of us weren't. Next slide. And so this is what we kind of saw the age group, you know, in terms of the side effects that they had and how they responded. I'm sorry. Okay, next slide. Next slide. Yep, okay. I think, you know, with this here, the side effects on the left side of the second shot range for a lot of different things, okay? But really nothing that most people were just tired, muscle aches, and it lasted for about 2 days. We weren't in the initial process, we weren't seeing a lot of long COVID like we're seeing now. So some individuals that got a vaccine that had COVID symptoms may have dragged longer, but early on we were seeing most of the symptoms with Tylenol, Motrin, you were controlling those things. And we were learning the science at the same time of following care. So we were doing a whole lot of different things. And what I wanted was, I wanted to put us all through that process to figure out, okay, when we go through the vaccine, what are all the things that can happen? So then when we're talking to individuals, these individuals will be ambassadors and really infect the community with information as to why the vaccine was so important. Next slide. Again, a lot of, I threw this slide in because it was just interesting what people's thoughts were. A lot of information that was also misleading were, you know, the Bell's palsy, the Tuskegee, you know, whether it's fertility issues, all related to the vaccine. You know, we were able to kind of get more information and really dismiss, you know, talk to them about why that information was not real. Next slide. One of the nice things about it was, so as we were giving vaccines within the systems, we were able to do data pulls from the demographics and also the vaccines and map out to make sure we were touching the right zip codes. And then, because what we did initially, and you'll have the next slide, is you saw where we saw where the infections took place. We wanted to make sure we mapped out the actual vaccines over that, because if people had the infection, they could get reinfected. So it was really important to hit certain targets. One of our zip codes that, you know, it's been bad since I've been here. It's the 14215. It's been a desert. The lack of primary care services in that region are often not very good. It got hit very hard. A lot of chronic diseases are all there. And so, you know, we have to start learning from the data how to really map out primary care. And I think primary care, because we focus on vaccines and also public health, it's something that we need more of, because we all saw that during this pandemic, it was very difficult to operate at the hospital level and other ways, the Department of Health, but you know, we're the Marines, we're there. We could do a lot of different things. And I could move and move our team, which was repurposed, to really figure out the best that we can do within this environment. And I think, you know, we have about 15,000 lives that we manage within our system, and we lost one person to COVID, once too many, but we were able to data pool, we were able to call people, we were able to kind of get put them at ease. We were talking about social determinants of health. All that stuff is real important in the process of managing a population during this time. And COVID's given us an idea that we really need to do a better job developing infrastructure that will help us do that in the future. But data, visualization, know when to target and do the right things was with a lot of things that we learned on the fly. But again, we try to share to make sure everybody was following the same types of standards. Next slide. Trendy. I think this became important for our offices because we knew when the hotbeds were going on. And as you saw, the trend has been going up. And so we're getting reinfected by different types of strains. And as a result of it, it's you're aware within your model or your footprint to make sure you let individuals know and also to push the vaccines. Next slide. We had our pharmacists, and I think Lavinia Baker did a really nice job during these meetings and really discuss a lot of the things. And we have it, you know, we posted it on our website where people got to understand the COVID-19 and the fact that it didn't affect the DNA and that, you know, it was just really simplified information. We have a lot of health literacy in our community, so we have to make things simple. And I think she was able to do that. And again, talking to the teams, staff, and patients, it was really informative. Next slide. We also created a vaccination type of cheat sheet for practices that wanted to kind of do this, how they can set themselves up to really do the right thing. So we were pushing that out to make sure that we got more primary care. So again, I was probably the first primary care in the state to give shots, but not because I was a primary care, because they tried something different that initially I didn't kind of agree because I didn't understand it. But then what they said was, we're going to create these pop-ups. And what we want you to do is we want you to look for a doctor or a medical establishment to help them with. So a lot of the groups reached out to me. And so we put our systems in there. And really, it was interesting because some of these individuals were not our patients. And what we found was there's a lot of patients that don't have doctors. And so they don't have that comfort. And now you're trying to tell them to take a vaccine, and there's a lot of questions that pop up, and we were able to do a really nice job with that. Next slide. This, what we try to do with a lot of the information is that the receptor binding domain, which is where a lot of the mutations took place, we try to describe that in a simple process so that they would understand where the spike proteins were creating the problem. Next slide. And we talked about, next slide. Yep, the UK. Why it was important, why it's so important for us to get vaccinated so that, you know, herd immunity was real important to us. So we made it simple. You got 10 people, we got 3 that are vaccinated, 7 that aren't. That virus is gonna continue to mutate. It's gonna survive and grow. And once one strand grows, it's gonna outpace everything else. So the game changes. And that's where we're seeing more long COVID, post-COVID syndromes. And it's because of that. But if we're fast to vaccinate, we wouldn't run into that issue. Next slide. We got into the South African variant, you know, which is already here. Next slide. We got the Brazilian. So there's a Brazilian one also. So what I found important there was we had 25% of the cases in the world. So we probably had all these variants here, but we weren't doing a lot of genome testing. And once we started doing the genome testing, we're seeing more of these strands already here. But what we do see also is that all the individuals that we've been able to vaccinate, and you're seeing all this inpatient and intubation and things like that, if you've been vaccinated, that's not happening. And so what we try to do is tell the individuals that it's important to get whatever vaccine's available to you, but at the same time as it's gonna, if you were worried about all the side effects of the vaccine, infertility, Bell's palsy, you name it, if you get COVID, you're going to get those. But if you get the vaccine, you're not going to get that because we're just tricking the body. One of the things that ended up happening in this whole process was I've been working with the ministers for a while. We're talking almost 10 years. And so we had developed a medical neighborhood model. And then we worked with the community-based organizations, creating this sort of connection. So when the pop-ups came up, that was easy because we created a format, but they don't have ways to communicate with us. So we had basically employed this whole on ribbon that allowed us to communicate across these entities to make sure that there was a referral management. And they could see information in an encrypted system. They can get us information into our system. And we needed a way or a platform to make sure people were being taken care of or at least issues being addressed. And this was very helpful during the pop-ups. Next slide. Again, it was almost like it's an Outlook kind of model, but with 128 encryption. So everything is secure. You can drop what it calls CCDs, continuous care documents, but we had information moving back and forth that in the background, we can create dashboards and really get a visualization that things were going okay. Next slide. So again, we started these pop-up events. Next slide. The first one actually happened at the Bell Center. So they called me, they said, we need some stuff. I said, okay. And we launched there and, you know, we did 450 vaccines. Our teams, you know, got together, set up the formats. We had a process. We had a thermal scanner, security walked people through. We were able to get them through the whole line to drop information. So by the time they got to the electronic record, we had a lot of their information. We can ask the appropriate questions. They would get vitalized. We vitalized everybody because if people got into trouble and you knew what their blood pressures were, you knew exactly what to do and what not to do. Otherwise, you might be treating someone that it's unrelated to the shot. One of the things that we noticed with our staff and also the patients were people were very anxious. And when I mean anxious is they're breathing very fast, hyperventilating, and that creates a lot of chemical changes in your body. And because of that, you could pass out. And so we were just calming people down, putting them through the process. But we ran this and everybody got both shots. So they got the first shot, they came back in 28 days and got the second shot. Again, they got the shot, they were watched. We had Dr. Fox talk to them about the information they needed to know. And we wanted to infect them with information so that they became ambassadors for us. And that happened at the Bell Center. Then once the Bell Center happened, next slide. We get call from the Native American Community Center. We want to do this. And I was pushing for that. So we got them, 400 shots. And we were able to kind of go through the whole setup. We took our mobile units and basically did the same thing we did at the Bell Center. Next slide. We went to the Northwest Community Buffalo Community Center. We did 540 shots. They hadn't had access to any shots. We set up, our teams went in, and we were able to vaccinate everyone during that time. The next slide was interesting. We went up to the Native Pride Travel Center, and this was the first in the country's vaccination of truckers. So we did the Johnson & Johnson. We gave out 700 shots. We didn't have any side effects or reactions, and I know that there was pause and it went through some stuff, but we didn't run into any of that stuff. And out of the almost, you know, of all the vaccines that we've given, we have not had a single side effect. And what I want to tell you is because we vaccinate, we're primary care physicians. We do about 300 to 400 vaccinations a month. If a problem is going to happen with a vaccine in terms of a side effect, it's going to be 30 days right after that vaccination. If it hasn't happened during that time, you're pretty much going to be okay. And since we did this, we haven't had any bad side effects. But just going to the Native community, it was just very, very, very important. We talked to the elders. You know, they felt like you understood. And the finding for me is Puerto Ricans, I have Taino blood. I am Native American. So it was just that connection that really resonated with me and J.C. Seneca. And we did this. We're going to do a health fair, and we're trying to increase more primary care services in that area. That community is really devastated because it doesn't have the services. And most people think because of the Seneca Casino that they do really well. But the only resources from that casino that they get, it's only 6% of it. Most of that wealth is being taken to Europe. Next slide. Then we went to Durham Memorial Outreach Center, big church, and we gave 500 shots. again, we were being asked to come to these centers. So that's why I said I'm probably the only primary care physician in Western New York, that in Buffalo, in New York State, that really vaccinated, because the churches and the community, they understood who I was and they understand what I do. And we just coordinated and we just did it. Every event got better and better and better. And just the individuals, and by touching their lives, and it was just, it was beautiful. The staff was just, they enjoy doing these things, and it's a lot of work to process 400 to 500 people a day. Next slide. So, you know, some of the things that we kind of, you know, we put on this last slide is we need to make a change, and that can come in a lot of different ways with partnerships. You know, primary care is essential, and I think we need to really focus more on that, but just teaching primary care physicians in our communities, because we manage chronic disease well, we were managing the hypertension, the asthma, and the diabetes with the medicines we use there. Those medicines help through the COVID process. Just information, health literacy, doing the right things, all that helped, because we just don't do enough in our communities. And hablo mucho idioma. Es importante que nosotros entendamos nuestra gente. Y a veces no. So it's so important that we understand our people, because during this COVID, we're kind of going out there in one language and not truly understanding the importance that language and culture become. So at GBON, in the organization I created, we have navigators and we speak 18 languages. So I think it's real important that, you know, we understand how diverse and how important that diversity is in healthcare. So like I said, the schools getting more Black and Brown and Native students in there, because people have to understand that New York State is 40% Black and Brown. And so if we're going to get to herd immunity, it's got to be 75% of that population that gets vaccinated. So I think, again, public-private partnerships are going to be real important. Healthcare disparity and improvement in social determinants of health are so important. I mean, it's if I often tell people that don't work for me to go around with one of my navigators and go into people's homes, and you will see how people live. We, in some parts of Buffalo, are in a third world country. And it's so sad to see that with so many resources that we have, and things have to change. So, you know, what I try to do is bring balance to the craziness. God has blessed me. You know, my two babies gave me that award. That I just want to thank you. That's all.
You're on mute, Dr. Dubakovich. Mute.
Thank you, Dr. Vazquez, for that inspiring personal story and for all what you do for our Buffalo communities and beyond. Your work is just truly outstanding. Thank you on behalf of all of us. So, now we are going to start the Q&A session that will be moderated by our discussants. Amanda Geiger, MD candidate class of 2024, who is the Polity president, and Nadia Vazquez, MD candidate class of 2024, who is community service chair for SNMA and the Lighthouse Clinic. We invite you to submit questions for Dr. Vazquez via the chat box, and Nadia and Amanda will read the questions to you. So, Nadia and Amanda.
The first question is, tell us about your childhood and life experiences and what inspired you to pursue a career in family medicine and community health?
Well, I think my life experiences, you know, you become the person. So I love my life because it got me to this point. It was very difficult because, you know, you don't have individuals that guide you. I think one of the stories is very interesting. So I came to Buffalo. I didn't know anybody in Buffalo. And I had a friend that applied, and I came in and I got in. Dr. Gattuso was the actual administrator at the time, and he was powerful. I fell in love with him, and I said, while here, the first week of medical school was the best time of my life. And what changed the game here was I went to Dr. Ricker at the admissions office, and And they said, you know, we they had an envelope and they were giving me an envelope. So at the time I thought, well, you know, I don't have any money, so I'll just go back home and it's okay. But it was actually a check for $37,000. It was the check was given because I was the poorest student ever getting to UB medical school. So I think those things made me kind of, everything was really covered for me. You know, I went to Fordham, but then because I went to UB, I had a tuition waiver. So God bless me with all that stuff. So I felt that, you know, my life is really dedicated to these communities. And we often forget, but those communities really create who you are. And today I do really well, but it's all because of that, those communities that really, you know, that really changed my life. So I always say it's important to really don't forget where you come from. It's real important.
The next question is, who was most influential in your life and why were they important to you personally and professionally?
I think, you know, I love my wife and, you know, it's, you know, we've done really good work together. One other person that really changed my life was my uncle Jim, because he only had third grade. He taught me real estate. He taught me grocery stores. He taught me the business of everything, you know? And I mean, his vision and I still, a lot of his life lessons are used today, but he always believed in me. And I thought that was key because, you know, growing up with your mom, I love her, but she never experienced some of these things, but he, no matter what, could figure things out. And I think I learned that talent from him. And it made me who I am today.
Okay, the next question is, how do we convince physicians of color to go back to communities that need service and that they could serve?
Yeah, I think it's being taught. I think everyone looks at primary care and they don't feel that you're doing well. You know, it's very difficult in terms of how you do it, but I'm changing that. I'm changing that by a lot of ways. So in the next year or two, there'll be major changes. And I'm recruiting primary care to kind of work in these communities. Value base and the way the economics of healthcare is changing, they're going to see that their value is really there. So I just see that they need better training in the community. With that is, you know, if you're in a war and they don't teach you how to use the tank well, and now you have to use that tank, it doesn't work well. So what our skill is, we want them to learn what they need to learn and then develop all the outside entities that support that. So they can go into private practice. You know, they can do other things out in the field and really change the dynamics, but not feel that because, you know, you're going in a black and brown population and it's Medicaid that, you know, you're not gonna do well financially. Well, I'm the opposite. I find that the way the economics are changing, it's real important for them to see that as an option. Hospitals will change in the next 5 years. You know, things are going to come that you never expected. Just like, you know, Amazon changed the way retail is. The same thing's going to happen in healthcare. So telehealth and a lot of mobile medicine, and that's going to require good primary care backbones in order to deliver care.
Our next question is, how can we best prepare our graduating medical students so that they understand these inequities and work to eradicate them when they are out in practice?
I think the important thing is link up, you know, we're growing other groups, the Jericho, they're out there, is you got to see it to kind of see the impact. And I think once you're out there and you see, you know, a lot of us want to travel to other parts of the world to really help. Well, if you get involved here, you'll see the benefits and you touch people. I've been able to take people on Medicaid, retrain them, and they work for me. They have sustainable jobs. And, you know, once you do that, I think my father-in-law always said there's three things that can change communities, right? And the three things are jobs, job, job. Because of the economic impact I've had in our area, the jobs and things it creates in other businesses, that's what's going to be real important. And so that's an area that they need to understand that they bring a change in terms of economics to these communities, which really need those kind of support structures.
And then the next question is, when did you realize that the COVID-19 pandemic was seriously impacting the community and that you needed to do something more to help? What did you do and who did you collaborate with?
Well, I think for me is that young lady there, Nadia, when she got it, I was just like, man, you know, this is different. And so what we ended up doing initially was I knew I couldn't keep my staff inside the buildings because they were going to get infected and we were just going to be a nevus for everybody else. So we, on a Friday after that episode with Nadia, I told everybody at noon, you're going to take all your equipment and I won't see you back for 4 months. We're going to just everybody, because we had been doing telehealth. Everything's going to be done remotely. We're going to repurpose people. And as we start getting people for testing, we're going to just rotate people around so that we're not keeping everybody out. And I think that started. I reached out to the churches and the community-based organizations. We created a plan and we were talking about strategies because we knew as it got worse, we might have to have a triage system because the hospitals weren't going to be able to take these individuals. And we needed to have isolation. We needed to have structure. People didn't have food. I mean, there was just a lot of stuff that the community just came together. I mean, it was just beautiful because we just had meetings and we were deploying. We had a pharmacy team, what drugs they can use, what drugs they shouldn't use. You know, when this community, who's gonna get food? How do we get transportation? Who do we get tested? We repurposed our apps. So I had 4 apps that we set up not only for the COVID testing. So if you couldn't get any way, you can put the information. We would notify our call system, would call them. The data that was being pulled and calling them and giving them information. The navigators, because they had a panel of people, would keep touch of everybody, making sure that they had what they needed. And if anything was missing in those gaps, we were just basically providing the services. The app had a survey for the social determinants of health. They had a survey once the vaccine came out so that there was structure. And I think our call system, we were getting about 2,500 calls a day. And because we were able to multi-use our people, we just, you know, we took our member services and office and some of transportation. Nobody was fired. We basically increased the platform to be able to handle that. Was it easy? No. But I think that helped us really looking at the data and decide what resources and how to really tackle these issues. All were triggered by that young lady because I knew that if it was hitting home, it's hitting home.
What do you hope will change as we move forward after the COVID-19 pandemic? What do we need to do to ensure that everyone has access to quality healthcare?
Well, you know, you've got long COVID, but then you have post-COVID. You know, these coagulants that were formed as a result of COVID and still happening have long-term implications. You know, we have people with kidney problems, lung problems, you know, brain issues, stroke issues, heart issues. All that stuff, if we had a good primary care base, because it's health equities that happen in these communities. And, you know, you don't want to say it that way, but it's almost like not a Tuskegee experiment, but we're letting people get sick and we don't focus on the wellness component. So you get to see the pathology in hypertension, right? You get to see the pathology in diabetes, which is not important. Yeah, we learn from these individuals, but it's not the right thing. It's how do we prevent all that stuff? I'm always tired to have the community and us, so Black and Brown and Natives be cash cows for the system. We have to change that. We really have to encourage more primary care and the wellness component. We started wellness back in a facility many years ago for GBON. And then in 2016, we put a gym. We have a kitchen, a nutritionist, you know, a chef. We have a pantry of food that we give people, but all those pieces, there's no reimbursement or structure for it. We do it because we know it's important, but the system has to treat well care as opposed to sick care, because that's the only way we're going to get out of this.
So do you like to ask it? One last question before time is up.
I can ask another question. Yeah. What would you consider the most relevant program that you developed?
I think for me, the most considered would be the health home, GBON, the Greater Buffalo United Accountable Healthcare Network. See, for many years, I try to do this. So in private practice, when I opened in 1996, And, you know, and during that process of opening the first day, one of my other daughters was being born. So Nina Vazquez, who's a second year going to third year medical school, was born during that area. And so I always was trying to figure out the madness, you know, like we had transportation, because as a Medicaid person, the eyes can only see what the mind knows. I know all the things that prohibit them from getting healthcare. And so I had this lab, you know, if we had that. So we would try transportation, food pantries, everything under one roof, the languages. And that was when the health home came around, I just implemented social determinants of health. You know, transportation, we had to take control and manage people, tell them, use what behavioral economics, you know, things that would keep them kind of engaged in the process. But just the care coordination, as a result of GBON, within 1 year, we had a reduction in ER by 64%, okay? And these were some really high-risk patients, and then admissions by 84%, and it was maintained, okay? That care coordination, social determinants of health, is so important to healthcare. It's 50 to 60% of our costs. So if you deploy resources there with good primary care, the combination is you can manage a lot of these individuals without the other stuff. So GBON in itself, and I created it from just thinking about stuff, because I was a mad scientist pulling ideas out, because I thought about it so long, and God gave me the opportunity at that time to deploy it. And it's changed a lot of people's lives. And I think not only changed them, but gave them, you know, purpose. They work for me. They're some of the, I don't know, so we're going to go across the state, not just in Buffalo. And that all happens because of people. I think when you invest in people, you're always going to do well.
Thank you. Thank you, Dr. Vazquez, and congratulations for this inspiring story and your lifelong work on behalf of our healthcare system and community. So let me thank everyone for participation and engagement. The session has been recorded and will be available for viewing for everyone, but particularly for those that were unable to attend. If you have questions or would like to follow up on any issue mentioned during the conference, please contact us. We look forward to seeing you at our next Celebration of Inclusiveness in Medicine and Science event. And thank you, and you enjoy your evening. Thank you to everyone again.